It's actually, the book of Judges is quite a fascinating book. For those who have been reading it, you realize that you can make a ton of movies out of the book of Judges. There's a lot of stuff going on in there. A lot of wild stuff. It's all summed up in the last verse of Judges, which says that everyone did what was right in their own eyes. And you get the kind of wildness that happens in Judges when people forget God's laws, people do their own thing, people decide that they're now their own master and that they can make up their own way of what's right and wrong. And then chaos enters into the picture, and that's what happened in the book of Judges when you read all the crazy stories of how people lived and talked and just this ongoing cycle of the Israelites. They follow God for a while and they have a godly leader. As soon as the godly leader dies, they abandon God, they embrace the idols of the nations around them. Then God hands them over for a period of time, and it's in that time of oppression and difficulty and hardship that they begin to wake up and they begin to cry out to God. And then God, in his mercy, raises up a deliverer who leads them back to God, and the cycle goes on. And sometimes that's happening in our own life, too. When things are good, we tend to drift away from God, and then some hardship comes, and then we're crying out to God again. And so that's not an unfamiliar cycle. Well, today I'm going to introduce you to a fellow named Jephthah. God used him to deliver his people from the hands of the Ammonites. For 18 years, the Ammonites oppressed the people of Israel, and they were crying, and they turned from their idols. They embraced the idols of the Philistines and the Sidonites and the Moabites, and then they began to put their idols aside and call on the Lord. And so they were looking for someone that would lead them and who would deliver them. So God had a man in mind, a man named Jephthah, a very flawed man. One of the things I was realizing as I read this is, by the time you get to the end of the account of chapter 11, you probably have forgotten all the good things the guy did. And the only thing that will stick in your mind is the glaring bad thing that he does. So what I want to do today is I want to do a little bit of a character study of a guy whose name actually ends up in Hebrews 11. You know the great chapter of faith in the Bible? There's nothing said about him, just his name is there. I believe it's Hebrews chapter 11, it's either verse 26 or verse 27. He's actually listed in the Hall of Faith as someone that trusted God, and yet he did something very terrible that we remember him for, instead of the good things that he did. So let's take a look at Judges 11. I'm going to read it. If you want to read more context, you could read basically all of chapter 10 to get the backstory. If you look in verse 18 of chapter 10, the leaders of the people of Gilead, they said to each other, "Whoever will take the lead in attacking the Ammonites will be head over all who live in Gilead." So they're looking for a leader. They're looking for someone to take the fight to the Ammonites who were oppressing them. And then we're introduced to the guy, Jephthah, the Gileadite, was a mighty warrior. His father was Gilead. His mother was a prostitute. Gilead's wife also bore him sons, and when they were grown up, they drove Jephthah away. "You're not going to get any inheritance in our family," they said, "because you are the son of another woman." And so Jephthah fled from his brothers and settled in the land of Tob, where a gang of scoundrels gathered around him and followed him. Sometime later, when the Ammonites were fighting against Israel, the elders of Gilead then went to get Jephthah from the land of Tob, and they said, "Come, be our commander so that we can fight the Ammonites." Jephthah said to them, "Didn't you hate me and drive me away from my father's house? Why do you come to me now when you're in trouble?" The elders of Gilead said to him, "Nonetheless, we're turning to you now. Come with us to fight the Ammonites, and you will be our head over all. You will be head over all of us who live in Gilead." Jephthah answered, "Suppose you take me back to fight the Ammonites, and the Lord gives them to me. Will I really be your head?" The elders of Gilead replied, "The Lord is our witness. We will certainly do as you say." And so Jephthah went with the elders of Gilead, and the people made him head and commander over them. And he repeated all his words before the Lord in Mizpah. Mizpah was where the tabernacle was set up. And so they took an oath in the presence of the Lord that indeed that they would have him as their leader. Then Jephthah, who was actually quite a history buff, Then Jephthah sent messengers to the Ammonite king with the question, "What do you have against me that you have attacked my country?" And so the king of the Ammonites answered Jephthah's messengers, "When Israel came up out of Egypt, they took away my land from the Arnon," maybe the next slide, Daniel, "from the Arnon to the Jabbok, all the way to the Jordan. Now give it back peaceably." One thing maybe you've noticed, that people trying to take away the promised land from the Israelites hasn't really stopped ever, has it? Here it is happening. You know, we've got the Israelites being encroached on by the Philistines and all the nations surrounding them. And now here we're introduced to a guy who says, "You know that land? That land is my land and I want it back. Just hand it over." Well, land claims as it regards the land of Israel have not stopped being an issue to this day. So the Bible's always relevant. Then Jephthah replied, and this is why I said he was quite a history buff, because now he's going to give you a lot of the history of Israel in his response. He rebuts this demand of this Ammonite king. He said, this is what Jephthah says, "Israel did not take the land of Moab or the land of the Ammonites, but when they came up out of Egypt, Israel went through the wilderness to the Red Sea and on to Kadesh. Then Israel sent messengers to the king of Edom saying, 'Give us permission to go through your country.' But the king of Edom would not listen. And so they also sent to the king of Moab and he refused. So Israel stayed at Kadesh." This goes back to the time when they came out of Egypt and they wanted to pass through some of the lands and the people were afraid of the Israelites and they said, "No, you can't step on our property." And so they had to go a longer way around. Next, they traveled through the wilderness, skirted the lands of Edom and Moab, passed along the eastern side of the country of Moab, and camped on the other side of the Arnon, the river. They did not enter the territory of Moab, for the Arnon was its border. Then Israel sent messengers to Sihon, king of the Amorites, who ruled in Heshbon, and they said, "Let us pass through your country to our own place." Sihon, however, did not trust Israel to pass through his territory, and so what did he do? He mustered all his troops and encamped at Jahaz and fought with Israel. Then the Lord, the God of Israel, gave Sihon and his whole army into the Israelites' hands, and they defeated them. Israel took over all the land of the Amorites who lived in that country, capturing all of it from the Arnon to the Jabbok and from the desert to the Jordan. Now, since the Lord, the God of Israel, has driven the Amorites out before his people, what right do you have to take it over?" So he's schooling him. He's giving him this history lesson to say, this is how we came to acquire this land. You actually have no right to it at all. I happen to know my history. And so he's giving them this history lesson. What right do you have to take it over? "Will you not take what your God Chemosh gives you? Likewise, whatever the Lord our God has given us, we will possess. Are you any better than Balak, son of Zippor, the king of Moab? Did he ever quarrel with Israel or fight with them? For 300 years, Israel occupied Heshbon, Aroer, the surrounding settlements, and all the towns along the Arnon. Why didn't you retake them during that time? I have not wronged you, but you are doing wrong to me by waging war against me. Let the Lord, the judge, decide the dispute this day between the Israelites and the Ammonites." Now, the king of Ammon paid, however, no attention to the message that Jephthah sent, reinforcing that you really can't negotiate with dictators and crazy people. We've learned that from history itself, a.k.a. Hitler. You can't negotiate with a tyrant. Well, this is what this guy was. The king of Ammon paid no attention to the message that Jephthah sent him. Then the Spirit of the Lord came on Jephthah. He crossed Gilead and Manasseh, passed through Mizpah of Gilead, and from there he advanced against the Ammonites. So those of you able to see this map, he actually took the fight to them. The Ammonites had been invading the Israelite territory, but the Spirit of the Lord directed Jephthah. They left the Israelite territory, and in fact, he took the battle to where the Ammonites were living. He devastated 20 towns from Aroer to the vicinity of Minnith, as far as Abel Karamim. Thus Israel subdued Ammon, who you remember had been oppressing them for 18 years and had seasonally invaded the Israelite country and stolen all their goods and made life exceptionally hard. So this is the breaking of that bondage that they were in. Now in Jephthah, in verse 30, this is where things get a little crazy. Jephthah made a vow to the Lord. So the Spirit of the Lord comes on him. He's going to take the battle to the Ammonites, but then he makes a huge mistake. Jephthah made a vow to the Lord, if you give the Ammonites into my hands, whatever comes out of the door of my house to meet me, when I return in triumph from the Ammonites, will be the Lord's, and I will sacrifice it as a burnt offering. Then Jephthah went over to fight the Ammonites, and the Lord gave the towns into his hands. He devastated those 20 towns, as far as Abel-Karamim, and Israel subdued Ammon. But when Jephthah returned to his home in Mizpah, who should come out to meet him but his daughter, dancing to the sound of timbrels? She was an only child. Except for her, he had neither son nor daughter. And so when he saw her, he tore his clothes, and he cried, "Oh no, my daughter! You have brought me down, and I am devastated. I made a vow to the Lord that I cannot break." "My father," she replied, and this is where things are strange too, "you have given your word to the Lord. Do to me just as you promised, now that the Lord has avenged you on your enemies, the Ammonites. But grant me this one request. Give me 2 months to roam the hills and weep with my friends, because I will never marry." "You may go," he said. And he let her go for 2 months. She and her friends went into the hills and wept because she would never marry. After the 2 months were over, she returned to her father, and he did to her just as he vowed, and she was a virgin. From this comes the Israelite tradition that each year the young women of Israel go out and for 4 days to commemorate the daughter of Jephthah the Gileadite. So, you know, if you were writing an account, you probably wouldn't have written in that last part, would you? You'd probably go with Israelites oppressed, this guy with a hard upbringing who's been run out of town, has become the hero, Israel's delivered, they live happily ever after, and things are great. But the Bible doesn't go that way. The Bible tells us what really happened in life. It tells us the good things about people. It also tells us the outright horrible things that people do. And so we learn that he makes this very foolish vow, with the result that he ends up killing because of his mistaken understanding of what God wanted. He does it in the name of God, of all things. And a lot of people over the years have done a lot of silly things in the name of God. And he ends up killing his own daughter, and which makes you forget almost all the good things that he did. But I want to take some time, because there's actually a lot of lessons that we can learn this morning. First off, I want to talk about some of the good things about Jephthah. We're going to talk about the good things, the bad things, and then we'll talk about some practical application for us. First, the thing that's good about him is he had a faith in God. You might look at it and say, well, his faith was pretty deficient in terms of his following. Well, that's a given, isn't it? And yet, he actually had a genuine faith in God. He was a follower of God. He seemed pretty serious about his walking with God, as corrupted as a view as he had. And how do we know he had a faith in God? Because he gets actually listed in Hebrews chapter 11 as one of the people who walk by faith. And that really, when we think about it, the most important thing is to be reconciled to God. And salvation has and always will be by faith. And we'll talk about that as an application. But we start with his faith, and he indeed had a true faith. He also, despite being mistreated by his family and his community, the good thing is he wasn't a grudge holder. You know, some people nurse a grudge their entire life. One day, if I get the opportunity to pay those people back, I will. But when the people come back, when they realize that, hey, you know, this guy that's living out in the wilderness, who's gathered all this group to him around him, you know, we need him to be the guy for us during our time of need. When they show up, and he of course questions them and says, "Hey, why are you coming to me now when everything's hard?" Nonetheless, we're coming. By the way, we want you to be the man. We want you to be the boss over us. And he's like, "Well, how do I know you're keeping your word?" But even though this dialogue happens, we don't read a sidebar that says, Jephthah, meanwhile, thought in his heart, "I'm going to kill everybody in sight after this is all over." That doesn't happen. What we see is that he actually has some maturity about him, in the sense that, you know, he's not nursing a long-time grudge of payback. He's got a forgiving heart. So that's a good positive thing about him. Another positive thing is he was strong. He was courageous. He was a leader who drew people to himself. He was the one that they were waiting for. And so those are some good qualities. He also made something of himself, and I'll talk about this a little bit later. He made something of himself despite having a rough upbringing and a bad background. You know, the Bible tells us that his mother was a prostitute and his father was Gilead. His father was an influential man who happened to be a philanderer fooling around on his wife and living quite a double life. And then we read about how his brothers kick him out of the house and he's driven out and the community has a part in expelling him from the community. But despite all that, he managed to do something with his life and become quite successful. He also was a keen student of history. You know, I mentioned earlier that actually knowing, and I'll talk about this a little bit more later, but knowing history is actually an important thing. I remember I hated history when I was in school. And, you know, learning about buffalo bladders and grade seven or whatever it was wasn't the most exciting thing in the world. Somehow that sticks in my head still, which, and so, but then I bump into people like Bruce, who loves history, and he can remember all sorts of arcane facts and details, which is kind of cool. So, and so, but the point is, history has its place, and we can learn a lot from history. So he spends a long time in this chapter walking us through Israel's history, but the purpose of it was to show that this was a bogus land claim. When this Ammonite is saying, give me this land back peaceably, he says, actually, it never was yours, and you have no right to it. And so, what's going on here? Why are you wronging me by doing this? And so he was able to prove from history that, hey, you've got no right to this land. And as I mentioned, issues of land claims in Israel never seem to go away. People are always wanting to take what God gave to them. He also, despite his critical flaw, actually seemed to be kind of a family man. This little girl, or however old she was actually the apple of his eye, and he was deeply committed to her. And so those are some of the good qualities. Sometimes you and I, when we see people, we forget to think about some of the good things that exist about them. Now there's the bad stuff, and you probably remember the bad stuff already. What's the big thing that he did? He kills his own daughter. Now, in today's modern commentators, lots of people like to debate, well, maybe he didn't really kill her because what's the emphasis there that she was a virgin and she's mourning the fact. So it seems to us, people that don't like the idea of him killing his own daughter, they're like, well, maybe he just devoted her to the service of the tabernacle for the rest of her life and that she was like cloistered and wasn't allowed to get married. Well, that's a novel idea, but commentators from the first century and moving forward, the universal view of the church has been that he indeed did what he said, that he killed his own child with this mistaken notion of what God wanted. And the next thing that we see about him is he tried to manipulate God. Have a look at verse 29 again with me, and then we're going to look at some lessons in a minute. Verse 29 says the Spirit of the Lord came on him and moved him so much so that he crossed the Gilead and Manasseh, passed through Mizpah of Gilead, and went there against the Ammonites. That's the Holy Spirit came upon him in power and directed him in his steps to go to leave the country and take the fight to the Ammonites. So God's at work in him. And yet, despite God being at work in him, he decides to open his mouth. And then Jephthah made a vow to the Lord, if you give the Ammonites into my hands, whatever comes out the door of my house to meet me when I return in triumph from the Ammonites will be the Lord's, and I will sacrifice it as a burnt offering. He made this incredibly foolish promise, but he also tried to manipulate God. God, if you will do this for me, then I'll do X and Y. And we'll talk about that in a moment, too. He made a very foolish promise, and then he stubbornly kept it. You know, he didn't have to keep that promise. There is a, in Leviticus, I think we've got the scripture here. Maybe I'll come across it as I work my way through here. But I found a passage in Leviticus that there was a ransom price that you could bring to the tabernacle in exchange for the promise. For a vow that you had made that you shouldn't have made. And so he had a very mistaken view of what God wanted, and this very rash promise. And rather than double checking it against the scriptures, he just went ahead and did what he said anyways. And that's his, the stubbornness of his heart. And then while having faith in God, and then he had a very poor grasp of how God had wanted him to live. That's evident in the fact that everyone, it's illustrated, everyone did what was right in their own eyes, and even a person of faith was making up his own rules along the way about how to follow God, rather than going to the scriptures. So the good, and I talked a little bit about application along the way, but now I want to zone in on that. We talked about the good about him, talked about the bad about him, but what are some lessons for us? Well, let's walk through, and if you see the overlap of where we've been already. When we think about faith, he had faith. Salvation is and always has been by faith. Abraham believed God, it says in Genesis chapter 15, verse 6, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Abraham, the father of faith. Salvation, peace with God, the forgiveness of sins, has always been by faith. And so when you think about coming to God, it's not coming by good works. It's not coming by trying to obey the Ten Commandments. The call of the scriptures is to put your faith in Jesus Christ. Salvation is by faith. It rests on the grace of God, and it's by faith in Jesus Christ alone. And so there is a call for faith. The next application is forgiving our enemies who wrong us, forgiving your friends who insult you and sometimes get under your skin. That's vital to us as Christians. He forgave these people that ran him out of his house and who said, "You're out of here," and he ran away to this a place called Tob, and he was out in the wilderness, and yet when he came back, his heart wasn't full of grudges and desires for revenge. He had moved forward and had given the offenses to God. Well, as Christians, we think about the forgiveness that we have in Jesus Christ, and Jesus says, "Forgive as you have been forgiven." And so when your brother and sister in the Lord rubs you the wrong way, when your family member, or your husband, your wife, your child, your cousin, your brother, your sister, whoever it is, when there's conflict, we're called to forgive. When someone who has it out for you and is making your life difficult, the Bible says, give that to God and work on forgiving them. You know, I think about a great example of forgiveness. He died this week, actually. Nelson Mandela, what people asked him, why did you forgive people, the people that wronged you? He says, well, the West End or the Methodists? I believe it's the Methodists. The Methodist preachers, when he was a kid, preaching, talked about Jesus, talked about how to have a right relationship with God, talked about the importance of forgiving your enemies. And he was a follower of Christ. How did he forgive people that wrongly locked him up for 27 years? So forgiveness is possible. So if we think, is it possible? Yes, not in our strength, but by Christ living in us. So we got to give our grudges and our bitterness and our anger, and give it to God, and we say, "Lord, I want to be like Christ. Help me to forgive." While our upbringing, this is an important point, while our upbringing does shape us, it's not an excuse for bad behavior, is it? A lot of people, sometimes we get these decisions in court where they're like, "Well, they had a really bad background, and so we're going to, we understand that they're, because of their bad upbringing, we're going to let them off." Well, no, this guy had a terrible upbringing, and he managed to work hard and take initiative and make something of himself. And so sometimes, we want to say, "Well, my past is stopping me," but there's some lessons in the scripture of people who they had bad backgrounds, and yet they still managed to do and take initiative and be successful. And there's a call embedded in there that for us, when you think about, and that ties, if you need counseling help because of stuff that's happened in the past, go get some help. But we shouldn't say, "Well, my past is bad, so I'm not going to ever do anything with my life." We have a good example in the person of Jephthah who made and went forward even though he had a hard life. That also reminds us, when you think about environment, it's not your environment that makes you. Adam and Eve, their world was perfect. And they totally messed it up. Right? And Joseph, everything, everywhere he went, he faced hardship and affliction. And yet he stayed faithful. And so we can't just say, well, it's my environment that makes me do stuff. It's the issue of the heart. And ultimately, when you give your life to Christ, he will help you through. And we look to God for his strength. Knowing our history will help us as the children of God today to face challenges and inspire us to live. When we learn about people in the past in the Bible, there's a lot to learn from their lives. And we're not to make the same mistakes. What happens when you forget history? You make the same dumb mistakes that people made before. So that's one of the big values of learning history, is it stops us from making the same mistakes that have been happening. Trying to manipulate God? That's a no-no. You know, in our prayer life, I'm guilty of it. You're probably guilty of it. We're like, God, if you would just give me this, then I will do X and Y. Because our eyes are fixed on that thing that we think will bring us joy in the moment, and it's the only thing we can think about. Sometimes we're obsessed about something or someone, and we're just like begging God to give us what we want. And we attach all sorts of conditions, like I'll never sin again, or I'll go to church, or I'll start tithing, or whatever silly thing we say, right? But the irony is God had already decided to give the Ammonites into the Israelites' hands. And yet he resorted to trying to manipulate God. God is the Father of every good and perfect gift. That's our Heavenly Father. He longs to give us good things. And so there's no need to try to bargain with God and manipulate God and say, if you do this for me, I'll do whatever. That's not to be what our prayer life is like. We also need to be careful about letting our yes be yes and our no, no. You know, this is the craziest promise a person could ever make. You know, if you give me victory, then I'll sacrifice whatever comes out of the door of my house as a burnt offering. Well, one, he's trying to manipulate God, and two, that's the dumbest thing you could ever say. Right? If you want to read crazy, go into the next chapter and read about Samson. That guy, you want to smack that guy. Beginning with the way he talked to his parents. I was reading that with my kids at the table. He's like, he sees this girl. He's like, comes back home to his parents and like, get that girl for me. Talk to your parents like that? So if you're irritated with Jephthah, wait till you get into Samson's life and read about him and how he was conducting himself. But you know, when we say something, the Bible says, you know, you should just say yes or no. You know, don't swear on your mother's grave or call God as your witness. You know, if you can, just say, I'm going to do that, or no, I can't do that. And in the script, James 5:12 says, above all, my brothers, don't swear by heaven or by earth or anything else. Let your yes be yes and your no be no. Now, there is sometimes you and I make a commitment to do something and we can't keep it. What should you do when you can't keep a commitment? Should you just duck out and say, I hope they forget that I said that? Or should you go talk to the person? Go talk to the person. Yeah, Proverbs, if you want to know how to address a promise that you make that you can't keep, read Proverbs 6:1-6. And basically it has you humbling yourself and going to the person and seeking to be released from the promise that you make. Too often, though, when there's something that we can't keep, we don't call them, we don't email them, we see them on the street, we cross over because we're like embarrassed. And so rather than deal with it like we ought to deal with it, we avoid the person. But the Bible says if you've made a commitment to do something and you can't keep it, the onus is on you to go and say, you know, I'm really sorry, I'm not able to do this right now. How can I make this up to you? And then another thing about promise keeping, when he made this promise, because God didn't want human sacrifice, that's the last thing in the world that he wants from people in the Old Testament and the scriptures. Where did he get that crazy idea? Because the Israelites had been influenced by the religions of the people around them. And we talked about Chemosh and the other gods that they actually literally offered their children as burnt offerings to their false gods. And when the Israelites kept on taking up the religion of these other nations, that sort of thought, God influenced people and crept into their consciousness. It's even crazier when you think that his daughter says, well, you made a promise to God, I'm surrendering myself to it. So the influence of the idolatry of the nations had crept into his thinking. There's some syncretism, that's a word for when you mix your faith with some other faith. Some syncretistic thought was in his way of walking with God. And it was wrong, obviously. And he could have, like I said earlier, he could have paid a certain number of silver coins for the release of her from that silly promise that he made. But he didn't. He was so stubborn that he's like, well, I made my promise, and I'm going to keep it no matter what. Ignorance of God's word will get us in trouble all the time. When we don't know God's word, we're going to make some really, really ridiculous decisions that will come back and hurt us, and we'll have the consequences to deal with. Now, actually, that one last point before I go to number seven. If you make a promise that's unbiblical, you have zero responsibility to keep it. Sometimes we think, well, I made a promise, and I'm going to keep my promise, even though you know that it goes against the word of God. If you make a promise to do something that violates the scriptures, you have this much responsibility to keep it. Because who is the Lord of our life? Anyone? Yes, Jesus. He's the captain, isn't he? And so if Jesus says you shouldn't be doing that, you and I shouldn't say, well, my promise trumps Jesus. No, your promise doesn't trump Jesus. Jesus' word trumps us. And we're supposed to bring everything into conformity with his will. And so if you have made a promise that violates the scriptures, don't do it. You would have said that to Jephthah. You'd be like, hey man, look at this passage right here. It says you shouldn't be doing this. And here's a way for you to pay to get out of this, in fact. And so we need to be careful with our words. We need to be careful with our promises. And we need to always say, what does the Bible say is actually what I'm making a commitment to doing? Is it actually line up with what God says I'm supposed to be making a promise about? Get into the Word. A knowledge of and commitment to God's Word will spare us a lot of grief. I think you can see that from Jephthah's life. If he'd only known the Bible a little bit better, he wouldn't have spent the rest of his days with the misery in his heart of having killed his own child. He didn't have to have that on his shoulders. And yet, if he had known God's word a little bit better, and maybe if someone else had stepped into his life and said, hey buddy, you're totally out of this one. And that's why we are our brother's keeper. We do have responsibility to each other as Christians to say, hey, what are you doing? You know, I love you, but you ought not to be doing that. You're going to bring harm to yourself if you do that. And how do we know what harm is or not? We read the word of God. We got to get into it. The Bible is our instruction book for how to live before God. The last 2 points, then we're done, is we need to deal with the Achilles heel that's in our life before it destroys us. You know, we all got weaknesses and sins that we struggle with perpetually, which can ruin us. Reputation and bring a lot of misery into our lives. When I look about the heroes of the Bible, this is the beauty of the Bible. It doesn't sugarcoat anything, does it? So you read about the awesome things that Moses did, then you realize he had an anger problem. Right? Then you read about David and you're like, wait a minute, that guy murdered a person and then tried to cover it up. Meanwhile, sleeping with Bathsheba. Right? He didn't have control over an area of his life. Samson and his problem with women. Barak, a bit of a chicken. Who else? Gideon, you know, we all like Gideon because he's like, you know, he goes, but then it says he said on the way out, after having the big victory, he's like, y'all give me one gold earring. And they're like, oh, that's not a big deal. So they all gave him from the spoils a gold earring, and it says he proceeded to make a gold ephod out of it, which was like a vestment that the priest would wear. Except he made one, I don't know why. And then people, it became like a shrine where they were now praying to this gold ephod, and it became an idol to the Israelites. Well, all these heroes, they all had something that was like part of their downfall. And you and I, if we're going to be good students of history, we look back and say, you know what? If I don't address some stuff in my life, That could majorly trip me up and ruin my reputation and cause me a lot of misery in my life if I don't deal with the sin that's there. That's why knowing the Word of God exposes the sin in our life, and then we say, Lord, I want to be like you. I want to live a holy life. And I need to deal with this. And then the last point is, we praise God for His amazing grace. Grace exemplified in the cross of Christ. You see, when I look at this guy, there's always, I find a little bit of hope. One, he gets listed in Hebrews 11, despite this massive thing that he does that's bad and wrong in the sight of God. And then, but I find it encouraging because, you and I sometimes think, well, can God use me? He can use anyone he wants, can't he? By God's amazing grace, he used Jephthah. Jephthah, despite an incredibly flawed faith, you're going to be able to talk to him one day because he got listed in the Hall of Faith. And yet we think about our own life. We think about the sins that we've committed against God and the decisions that have been wrong and we've made. And then we think, how amazing is God's grace and forgiveness that it's not by works that I'm saved. It's by faith and by faith alone. And my salvation rests on God's grace and mercy. And that's exemplified in the cross of Christ and Jesus, who came on a rescue mission to save us from our sins and from the judgment to come. Let's stand together as we sing our closing song.